In my previous podcast, I explained the difference between investment banks and commercial banks, and I mentioned that investment banks were the institutions that raise capital for governments and businesses. But as for the places where us regular people have to deal with when it comes to our money, you know, in savings accounts and checking accounts, it's a little more complicated. When it came to this area of banking, I've usually been referring to commercial banks as the places where most people go to deposit their money, but there were other institutions as well. These other institutions were thrifts and credit unions. Thrifts are like commercial banks. Both of them are for profit. The major difference between the two is the banking services they specialize in. Commercial banks were the ones you went to if you wanted a variety of financial services, whereas thrifts specialized in selling mortgages. In fact, originally, thrifts were the only institutions allowed to sell mortgages. Because of funding from the Federal Home Loan Bank, thrifts typically offered higher returns on savings accounts over commercial banks. Credit unions, on the other hand, are non-profit and democratically run by members. Since they are non-profit, they offer higher deposit rates and lower fees than their for-profit counterparts. Now that I've explained a little bit about the different types of banks, it's time that I talk about the regulators. Back in the day, before Glass-Steagall was repealed, most of these banks had specified regulators. The Securities and Exchange Commission regulated investment banks. Then the Federal Reserve, Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, and Comptroller of Currency regulated traditional banks, or commercial banks. The Office of Thrift Supervision was in charge of thrifts, and the National Credit Union Association regulated credit unions. Now, I have an asterisk next to the SEC and the OTS, and this is because the SEC no longer regulates investment banks, and the OTS is currently undergoing some major changes. The important thing I want you to get out of this slide is that there were a variety of regulators for these different financial institutions. Here's where the problem began. Remember when I was talking about how with the repeal of Glass-Steagall, the walls between investment banks, commercial banks, and insurance companies were removed? Well, this brought up a lot of confusion in terms of what firms who were expanding into general financial services had to do in terms of regulation. Let's take the case of AIG. AIG was in the insurance industry, which was heavily regulated and had a lot of restrictions. But with the appeal of Glass-Steagall, this insurance giant was given the freedom to go into other areas, such as banking. Well, AIG did add a banking and thrift side, and because of this change, they needed to find a regulator for their non-insurance line of business. Because they had a banking side, AIG could either be regulated by the Fed, the FDIC, or the OCC. Since they had a thrift, they could also be regulated by the Office of Thrift Supervision, and since regulation laws were lax, the company only had to pick one of these regulators. In fact, it was common for many companies to sort of move around from regulator to regulator, kind of trying each of them out before they settled on one permanent one. NPR's Planet Money likened the situation to a company dating around before making a final selection. When it came to regulation, the Fed and the FDIC had reputations for being on the stricter side. The OCC and the OTS, on the other hand, were more on the lenient side. AIG wanted the regulator that would give them the most flexibility and really stay out of their business. Well, the OTS offered the perfect opportunity for that. So naturally, AIG selected them as their permanent regulator. So AIG decided to go with the Office of Thrift Supervision as their regulator. And as said before, the Office of Thrift Supervision was very lenient and sort of let AIG do what it wanted to in its business side. And as a result, when AIG started going towards a very risky area of the financial services industry, which was called credit default swap, the OTS didn't necessarily have the experience or the financial background to sort of regulate this products. The result was that when the financial crisis hit, AIG ended up having a lot of problems with their credit default swaps, to the tune of losses in the billions of dollars. The result? In September 2008, AIG had to be bailed out by the U.S. government. putting this into a larger picture, what you see is a case where they would be adding regulator after regulator to accommodate our evolving financial services industry. But as laws changed and allowed for more deregulation, our regulatory system did not adapt to the fact that our financial services industry was rapidly changing and taking on more risk. This, in the long run, played a crucial role in affecting our entire financial system, and thus leading up to the current economic crisis. To review, with deregulation, many banks were able to choose from a variety of regulatory agencies. But some of these regulatory agencies had varieties of strictness, and many of these financial institutions chose the more lenient ones. The existing regulatory system in the United States could not accommodate the changing financial landscape since Glass-Steagall was repealed. Coming up, what went wrong with credit rating agencies, and how this flawed rating system contributed to the economic crisis. Thanks for watching. To learn more or watch more podcasts, visit www.subprimethemusical.wordpress.com.